Thank you, Seth, and greetings to all. Thank you for inviting me here today. My paper, as Seth said, is titled A Curious Conundrum, The State of Holographic Portraiture in the 21st Century. I'm not sure if this should have been in the art section or the commercial section. It's definitely about making money, and it's also art to me, though. So, for the last 14 years or so, I've had the distinct pleasure and honor of being a pulsed holographer specializing in pulsed portraiture. So the practice of representing the physical and psychological likeness of an individual is as old as art itself. The principal methods of portrait making, that is, painting, sculpture, and photography, have each been used successfully to immortalize one's essence of being, the mystical, magical, and spiritual nature of the portrait has long been associated and accepted within each of these methods. A relatively newcomer, holography and its unique ability to accurately record and reconstruct original wavefronts particularly lends itself to this form of artistic endeavor. It is exactly this capability of capturing the wholeness of an individual's likeness that makes holographic portraiture so alluring and potentially attractive. So here I want to define what a holographic portrait is. I am defining a hologram portrait as any type of portrait that uses science and wavefront recording and reconstruction, classically known as holography, either partially or wholly in its method of producing a three-dimensional image of an individual's likeness. For the bulk of my presentation, I will be discussing what I consider to be true hologram portraits, and that would be holograms that are made with the original image capture and subsequent reflection copy being both generated by holographic means, that is, pulsed lasers. I do want to make the distinction of what I feel is, a misnomer in the fact that the recent publicity and of like the Tupac hologram and CNN and those types of holograms, that's classically misuse of the terminology. So we have what I consider to be the three major classifications of hologram portraits. We have the classic pulsed hologram. We also have the stereogram, where it's a photographic image capture and then subsequently transferred into a hologram, most usually as a rainbow transmission hologram. And then we have what is kind of a hybrid of that, and that is the newer full-color digital holographic technology, the direct right full-color reflection hologram that are produced. Okay, so the short history, I'm sure everyone's familiar with it in this room. 1967, Lawrence Siebert did the first pulsed hologram portrait. It was a self-portrait. It was done on Halloween night in 1967. I think I might have chosen to conduct the experiment a day later. It's just a bad night for it to be started. In 1971, there was a pulsed hologram portrait that was completed of Dennis Gabor by Reinhardt while he was working at McDonnell Douglas, and that was to commemorate the Nobel Prize for the discovery of holography. I believe that is residing here in the MIT Museum. I have a partial list of people that I consider significant in the advancement of holographic portraiture. This is a partial list, by no means complete and accurate. Likewise, here's a partial list of noteworthy holograms that have been produced in the past. You'll notice that there's some quite famous people on there. I wish that there were more. I mean, and like I said, it's a partial list, but there's been no real advancement in holographic portraiture of doing figureheads and heads of state in pulse holography for some time. The example right here of Ronald Reagan, he is the only U.S. president to have ever had a pulsed hologram recorded. It was done by Hans and his colleagues. And, you know, I find it a shame that every president is not recorded in pulse holography as an archival method for historical reference. It's, you know, the most accurate form of recording known to man, and I feel that we're underutilizing this medium, important. I'd also like to, you know, I think of people in our society today that would that I would personally want to see pulsed hologram portraits of. I think of, you know, people that have, you know, made significant contributions to the betterment of society, like, for instance, the Dalai Lama or Nelson Mandela or Stephen Hawking. Can you imagine a pulsed hologram portrait of Stephen Hawking? How powerful that would be to be able to see him in a personal way like that. It conveys a emotional state and essence, you know, that would be truly remarkable to see in these type of individuals. Steve Jobs, why wouldn't we have wanted to have recorded him in a pulsed hologram for his offices in Apple? Think of how he was so instrumental in that company, and how his pulse portrait could have been displayed and still been a source of inspiration for his people that work there. So I'm going to talk a little bit, very briefly, about the basically two different types of lasers for pulse holography. The first laser is the pulsed ruby laser, of course. It was the first laser invented. There are many laser systems like this made by JK and Mnemonics that are still readily available today. So it's a usable laser. One of the problems that I see associated with pulsed ruby lasers is the 694 nanometer wavelength output. You know, it tends to not reflect well off of human skin. And that can be a problem. You need larger doses of radiation to image well, and so I see that as a major obstacle in a pulsed ruby laser. Additionally, they're notoriously high maintenance and difficult to keep aligned properly, and they also generally use three power phase electricity, which, you know, is a fairly inefficient laser, uses a lot of electrical cost for the operation. Another problem is the problem with beam cleaning in a pulsed ruby. So classically, pulsed ruby systems have had to have a second continuous wave laser for their transfer setups. That is an additional cost and space needed. So that's a problem I see with a pulsed ruby as well. So my career in pulsed holography has been almost entirely using the newer pulsed neodymium YAG-YELF systems. Specifically, I'm used to using the pulsed neodymium YELF hybrid system, glass phosphate systems. These lasers are commercially available, and there's cameras, systems, and the lasers are available from Geola. They're currently being manufactured today. They are frequency doubled lasers so that they have a 526 nanometer output. That is a much better light for reflecting off a human skin. It's also a very low maintenance laser. I can attest to having been involved with three different laser systems of this design that they are excellent in the ability to be stable, reliable systems that allow you to concentrate on the imagery and not on the laser mechanics to make successful portraits. They have they're a very efficient laser. They have low operating costs and a very small compact footprint. Another major advantage I see to the pulsed neodymium YELF systems are you are able to use the same laser system for the recording of your H2 transfers. You don't need a separate continuous wave system. They work fine with beam cleaning, spatial cleaning, and they produce excellent transfers, the same system. And they're also much more readily available green-sensitive holographic materials on the market currently. So you have a broader range of materials to choose from for recording. The materials that are available currently, that are commercially made, we still have the Slavich VRPM film and glass plates that are in production. Those are also available by Geola. We have that as a green pulse sensitive material. Yves Gentit in France makes a ultimate material that in the 15 nanometer or the 25 nanometer green size is suitable for pulsed radiation, and that's available in both red and green materials. Orwo, I believe, still believes makes a film in a green pulse sensitive material, and Color Holographics still makes their BB520. There's other manufacturers that are making materials sensitive to green pulse, but unfortunately they're not in the sizes required to do portraiture. Ilford, Agfa, and Fuji holographic materials, which have classically been used in the past for pulse telegraphy, are no longer commercially available, and there are still, however, some of these materials on the surplus market. Here's a little chart that I made of my 11 years in pulse, 12 years in pulse telegraphy between two studios, one in Nashville, Indiana, and the other in St. Charles, Missouri. It shows a breakdown of, we did just over 200, between 200 and 250 portraits during this time frame. And this shows the commission, the people that actually bought a portrait and what they bought a portrait of. As you can see, overwhelmingly, the majority of holographic portraits that we have done to date, 65-some percent, are of children, either children, their children, or of grandchildren. The breakdown shows a couple of other interesting things, like, for instance, dogs. People love their dogs, and so 4% of all the hologram portraits we did were of dogs. We did a number of couples. This is an interesting thing. We even specially marketed for trying to do wedding portraits, and in this whole time frame, although we did do some holograms of couples for anniversaries and things like that, there was not one wedding commission during this whole time. So that's an interesting fact, I think. Another thing that's important to note is that of all the imaging we did, I mean, generally, because of the ultra-realistic and high-resolution nature of the recording, we didn't do many women over the age of 30. You know, they just didn't want to have their portraits done. So it's important to think that way, and if you decide, you know, that you're wanting to have a holographic image done, you know, there's certain periods of one's life that are, you know, predisposed to being a perfect time for that to happen. Here's another little chart that I made that shows what I consider to be some of the marketing factors that determine the different portraiture mediums. We have the three classic: sculpture, painting, and photograph, and then I've listed some of the ways that those the factors that are determining whether or not that's a viable or a aesthetically pleasing form of imaging. We have, it's interesting here in this to see that in the hologram, and I'm speaking of a pulsed hologram here, the realism and the uniqueness are both in a high category. The cost is also high, of course, but the versatility being low, I consider to be actually an advantage. By unique versatility, I mean the ability to alter the image, to do different things with it, and you know, that can be actually seen as a positive in the unretouchable nature of a hologram. So let's talk about aesthetics in pulsed holograms, portraits. Let's be frank, it's not hard to make a scary hologram, you know. In fact, I have been commissioned to do specifically, you know, scary holograms for horror movie and things like that. What I feel are some of the reasons why we need to work on aesthetics in pulse portraiture is the fact that the public's perceptions are fickle, and we have a generational change about to take place where we have the opportunity to present pulsed holograms to a new market, and they may be more accepting of that. Classically, you know, in the last 14 years, are we down to this already? Huh? Really? Okay, we have to speed things up. The what I consider the rules of doing successful pulsed holograms portraits is the same as photography. I started in my background in photography. So creating a aesthetically pleasing hologram means, you know, you want to be a good photographer, you take a lot of photographs. You want to be a good holographer, you take a lot of holograms. It's the ability for the holographer to put, you know, people at ease, and actually that is a difficult situation in a pulsed holography lab with the lighting and the safe light conditions, particularly for children's. Another thing is the cost of the material. You have to weigh the cost of the material versus the number of master transmission holograms or proofs that you do. You know, 3 to 5 holograms proofs is a minimum to you know, successfully get a suitable portrait for transfer copies. Let me speed things up here. Here's a list of what I consider some of public's perceptions on holograms portraits. Again, this is pointing out that, you know, we live within a fast-moving and highly evolving technological society, I think that the opportunity is available for a new generation of people to see pulsed portraiture and be able to experience it and maybe have a little more conditioning to the response. The ultra-realistic, the realism of the medium is maybe perhaps more inviting and more acceptable for them. I know it is for me. I embrace holographic portraiture. I'm not afraid of it. This shows basically my company's history. We were founded in 1992. We gained our first pulse holography studio from a Geola system in 1999. In 2003, we installed another pulse holography system for Alan Fox in St. Charles, Missouri. And in 2008, my pulse holography studio closed due to economic conditions. That same year, I was contracted by Ron Olson and a company in Las Vegas, Nevada to run a pulse holography studio there. That successfully worked for approximately 6 to 8 months, and then we were forced to close. And am I this far over?
Yeah, sorry.
Huh. So currently, to my knowledge, in the U.S., there's only two commercial functioning pulse studios in operation. The one in St. Charles, Missouri, and the one run by Ron and Bernadette Olson in what is now Pulse Barrel, Washington. I was going to talk a little bit about my personal emotional unique response. It's not a shameless plug to show all my children here, but I have two children and I have had the unique opportunity to be able to record them during their lifetime, their childhood, and I have this physical record that I think is unique not only within the general public, but even in this amongst my peers. The ability to have these perfect, recordings of my children to be able to look back on as I get older in age is just absolutely priceless to me. My daughter is now expecting a child that will be born in November of this year. And I look forward to being able to make a pulsed hologram of her child, but also think of what her child will have when she grows, I know it's a girl, when she grows up and sees that she has these pictures of her mother through childhood in this perfect form of imaging. It'll be an absolutely priceless thing for her. Quickly, I want to talk about digital holographic portraiture.
I'm sorry. Okay.
Okay. So I'll just run through this. Okay, so in conclusion, the true holographic method is the most accurate and realistic form of imaging known today. In pulsed portraiture applications, the three-dimensional nature, extreme resolution, and realism of the portraits themselves, combined with their unalterable and archival properties, make it a powerful method for constructing an individual's likeness. The technology exists and yet is grossly underutilized presently in today's society. With continued dedication and education and a little patience, I believe the time may be nearing where the public's awareness, perceptions, and appreciation of a true holographic likeness coincide to produce a watershed event in which holographic portraiture becomes a commercially sustainable industry. It is the view of myself and a slow but growing number of others that this is simply a matter of when, but of when and not if this will occur. I want to also thank and acknowledge the following people because they actually were instrumental in helping me with my dream of being able to be a pulse holographer. So I wanted to make note of that. Thank you.